Good afternoon. We're going to go ahead and get started because we have a number of industry experts that have some information they want to share with you. Yes, that's you all. And we want to make sure that we have plenty of time, not only for them to share information with you, but also to answer questions at the end. And since we've had this wonderful thing about running a little behind today, we're going to try to stay on track. And we don't have any major technology involved, so hopefully that'll go well. Aside from, okay, we're good. Matt says we're good, so I'm really glad. Okay, this is the school panel town hall discussion. So if you didn't plan to be on this plane, you're in the wrong one, and exiting now would be appropriate. But if you did plan to be here, this is a repeat opportunity from last year that is backed by popular demand. We evidently got lots of cool remarks about the panel that we had last year talking about what they perceived from their institutions as compelling financial aid issues in a town hall format. So we're back with five different people to do exactly the same thing. So let me tell you a little bit about who we have. First of all, I apologize to them already, and now I want to apologize to you. I have shortened their bio something fierce just to get it through this process, and because the experience, the level of experience, and the time in the industry, these people are just really at the top of their game, and their resumes go on and on and on. So I have shortened them, and I hope you understand that after you hear what I say about you, which is going to be very little, and about the same amount for each person. A little equity there. Okay. The first person we have on our panel and the first expert we have is Cynthia Butler. Cynthia's right there on the end. Cynthia is the applause are okay. Yeah, I understand. While I'm talking about you, I understand that we have an award that goes to the school with the largest amount of people in attendance at this conference. And guess who that is? DCCCD, right? Okay. So there you go. Cynthia is the Executive District Director of Financial Aid at Dallas County Community College District with responsibility for district-wide financial aid. Prior to joining DCCCD, Cynthia worked as an executive consultant of higher education, an account executive for former lenders in the FEL program, and is a veteran director of financial aid. Cynthia is a longtime member of national, regional, and state financial aid associations and has also served on numerous boards and committees with a focus on student access and strategic planning. Next to her, Deb Barker Garcia is the vice president of Corinthian Colleges. She brings over 28 years of in-depth knowledge of financial aid programs and processes. Prior to that 28 years, Deb spent more than 12 years working with the University of Southern California as assistant director of financial aid, as well as working with Ed Fund for 13 years. Deb is a past president of the California Association of Student Financial Aid Administrators, better known as CASFA, and has served on and is very active on numerous committees at the local and national and regional student financial aid association levels. Next to her, Millette Leaf Green is the Assistant Director of Financial Aid at Texas Christian University in Fort Worth, where she has worked for 14 years. Millette is the current TASFA president and has served on numerous TASFA committees, numerous TG committees, and other lender advisory groups, as well as held leadership chair roles on many of those committees. Millette is also active at the state, regional, and national level of financial aid association and associations and has been a recipient of individual and committee awards. Millett is a regular speaker at national, state, and regional conferences. James Gaeta, next to him, our Lone Mill Ranger. Representing, okay. Has been a higher education professional for over 26 years. He is currently the Director of Financial Aid at Southwestern University in Georgetown, Texas. Prior to his tenure in financial aid, James served as the Associate Director of Admissions, where he spent 12 years. James is an active member of the College Board, Southwestern Regional Council, and has served on many state, regional, and national and special efficiency groups and committees. He also participates on numerous TG advisory committees and has been active with our registrar, admissions, and business office associations and committees. Last but not least, behind me, I feel like you are, is Cecilia Jones. Cecilia is kind enough to step in for another representative who is listed in your agenda. That is not Antonio Holloway. She is much more attractive than Mr. Holloway. But she stepped in at the last minute because he had an engagement that he just had to adhere to and wasn't able to make it, and sends his regards. Cecilia currently serves as the Director of Financial Aid at Wiley College in Marshall, Texas. She previously served at Texas College and Tyler Junior College as Director of Financial Aid and as a key default management leader. Cecilia has spent a great deal of her career working at minority-serving institutions in Texas. Cecilia is also an active member of TASFA, where she currently serves on the board of directors. She has served as chair of the Independent Colleges Efficiency Committee and served on numerous TG advisory committees. Each panel member is prepared to provide you a 10-minute summary of their compelling issue, and I will ask the audience to hold your questions until the end, so you may want to jot them down so you'll remember, so that every panel member has an opportunity to highlight their issue. Okay, what are their compelling issues? Cynthia will be highlighting managing default aversion at a community college. Deb will be highlighting political environment and heightened oversight of career schools. Millett will be highlighting verification struggles and defining what sufficient income means for the new V6 group. And I was supposed to do this with sufficient income. James will be highlighting the financial aid office's role in the recruitment race. How can we better support the mission? And last but not least, Cecilia will be highlighting institution-wide default management programs with emphasis on HBCUs. She's going to combine Antonio's vision of his presentation and her own to come up with a whole new presentation. So please join me in welcoming our auspicious panel. And Cynthia, your time starts now. Do I need to give her another mic, or what are we doing?
Hang on just a second.
So your 10 minutes does not start now. We'll give you a few extra. Try it now, Cynthia. Let's just give her Deb's mic. Is that okay in the back? We just give her another mic?
Yeah.
Okay.
Hello?
Hello? Can you guys hear me here?
Yes.
Yeah. Okay, I'm going to give this one to Cindy.
Okay, Cynthia, your time starts now.
Okay, now can you hear me?
Yes?
No? Okay. I'm going to start off with some statistics for the Dallas County Community College District so you kind of understand our infrastructure. We have approximately 85,000 students, and we have 7 colleges that consist and make up our district. We recently restructured financial aid in 2011-2012 and centralized the financial aid function. Okay, now can you hear me?
Hold on a minute. He's got to turn you on back there. Yeah.
No.
Try now.
Okay. Yay. Now you can hear me. Okay, sorry. All right, so let me start over so you can understand what I'm saying. Our district comprises of 7 colleges. We have approximately 85,000 students, cumulatively speaking. And in 2011-2012, we restructured financial aid and centralized that function so that all 7 of our college financial aid offices report up through the district office as opposed to reporting specifically at each individual campus. And we did that for a lot of reasons. We did that for consistency. We did that for compliance purposes, for a lot of different reasons. And so it's worked out very well for us. We are in year 3. With that being said, one of our major challenges was to maintain and reduce our cohort default rate. And with 7 different colleges, you can imagine, we were doing 7 different practices where default aversion was concerned, and the default rates were continuing to go up. So it was a great concern, not only for the district office, but for all 7 colleges. The presidents were concerned, the vice presidents were concerned, all the financial aid offices were concerned. So how do you approach that? How do you tackle that with as many students as we have? And we have approximately 60% of our students that are on some form of financial assistance. So one of the initiatives that came from the chancellor down was to, how do we minimize students taking out student loans? Why at the community college are our students borrowing so much money? We had 2 specific instances where I personally spoke with students last fall, as an example, that were already at or very close to their aggregate limit for borrowing, you know, the $57,000 income level for an independent student without an associate's degree. Okay, big concerns. This was shared with our chancellor's staff meetings, which consist of all the presidents, various different executive members of the Dallas County Community College District, and the chancellor himself. And by the way, we have a brand new chancellor, too, that just began his tenure with the district in February. Dr. Lassiter recently retired. But Dr. Lassiter's concern was the fact that our students were continuing to borrow so much money. And so that began a real emphasis and focus, if you will, on default aversion, the management of that, and what we can do to control the borrowing and to minimize the amount of loan debt that students would have to repay. So we did several different things. We did an initiative where we changed our cost of attendance. In the past years, we always used a cost of attendance based on full time. That was our default cost of attendance. We changed that last year in 12-13 to a half-time cost of attendance as our default. Now keep in mind that after that 12th class day, we go in and we adjust the students' enrollment or registered hours based on what their actual cost of attendance should be. But in our basic packaging philosophy, if you will, we are using a half-time cost of attendance. And the reason that we're doing that, I kind of took a lead from another community college that's doing a very similar practice, because when you look at who our students consist of and how many hours they're taking in our district, typically speaking, most of them are less than half-time. So with that being said, We were making so many adjustments because of having a full-time cost of attendance that it was becoming a very time-intensive project to go in and have to reduce all of those cost of attendance to meet the majority of our students who were less than half-time or half-time or three-quarter time. But we found that our reductions are have reduced. I'm not going to say as much as we would like, because you still have those adjustments that you have to make, upward or downward, depending on what their actual hours consist of. But it has worked better for us. We made a conscious decision for 13-14 to continue that practice. And we are going to continue that as well for the 14-15 award year. It just makes sense to us to do that. Now, when you do that, what it's done to impact our default aversion area is our packaging philosophy is to give as much gift aid as possible. We have institutional money, we have state money, we have federal money. And so our packaging philosophy is to give as much gift aid as possible. So keep in mind, we have those half-time cost of attendance budgets. Then we are subtracting out their EFCs and giving whatever their remaining need is. And then we're fulfilling that remaining need with gift aid as much as possible, thereby minimizing how much eligibility they have remaining for loans. That has made a difference. It's going to take a while for us to see the actual outcome to hit the default aversion when they start the repayment of that, because it will minimize, from our perspective, at least at the community college level, how much they're borrowing. And we're hoping that by minimizing the amount that they borrow, that it will give them the ability to repay those loans. It's a little frightening to think of a student who has not obtained an associate's degree to have borrowed their aggregate limit in loans, and to even begin to think that they're going to have the ability to repay those loans. It's downright frightening. And so when this came to the attention of our chancellor and the presidents for each of the colleges, they were pretty mortified by that. And so that was one of the initiatives that came down from them. Can you look for ways to help minimize how much our students are borrowing? And what we also found is that we have a fairly large foundation with a lot of institutional scholarships that in some cases were not being fully allocated. And we wanted to be able to utilize those sources first and foremost, and then minimize how much the students are actually borrowing. Now, I can tell you on the downside of that, from a student perspective, we have had students that have come back to say, I don't understand. I borrowed $10,500. Why can't I have that again? And then we've had to go through the explanation of with the cost of attendance changes. So some of our students haven't been very happy with that. But as you know, there is a push from the state level and from the federal level for students to get in and out of school, right? So they no longer have the ability to get in school and be a professional student. And we had some of those at our district, the professional student. And in some cases, we had students that were there just to be, they would take enough classes, be degree seeking, change their program of study so they could continue to receive financial aid. And it's been a real big issue for us. And so with this initiative, you are going to have some students, if you choose to go down that road, that may be resistant to that cost of attendance. And it does take some explanation, and it takes some getting used to from a student perspective. But what I've had to explain to some of the students that I've had personal contact with is we are doing that for the benefit of you. We are trying to protect how much money you are borrowing. I said, you may not understand that today, but you're going to understand it tomorrow when you have hopefully completed your degree with Dallas County, transferred to a four-year, completed your bachelor's degree. You're going to have the ability to continue to finance your education for a bachelor's degree, because that was a concern of ours. How, as a community college, could we expect our student to be successful and complete their degree, have the ability to finance their education and go on to complete their bachelor's, or even more, and to complete a graduate degree, if you will? So we were very concerned about that. So we're trying to look at the whole welfare of a student. The other major implementation that we did is we are partnering with TG, with Higher Edge, so that we can further reduce our cohort default rates. We have some predictions from TG that, some projections that we are going to be down at 15.9% overall district-wide, and that's seven different colleges, by 2012, so when we get those default rates. And so we are continuing to come down in our cohort default rates, and so we are very pleased by that. This past year, we are down. We had one of the seven colleges that had a 0.05% increase that we are currently challenging with TG's assistance, so that we can ensure that our default rates are continuing to go on the downward side. So we are very aware of what our cohort default rates. We're pleased with the percentages that are continuing to go down. Our presidents are aware that our cohort default rates are diminishing and coming down, and we are going to continue that initiative and hopefully be able to continue to minimize, since we can't just tell a student how much loans they can have or just tell them across the board you can only borrow a certain amount of loan debt, although I think most of us in this room that are a community college institution would like to see some type of Department of Ed guidance on that so that we're not the bad guys. So in lieu of that, we have tried a different route to help minimize what our students are borrowing so they can repay them and be successful in their lives. And we are taking a full approach with financial literacy so that we are working with them while they're in school, when they're in their grace, during their repayment, and then preventing those defaults and rehabilitating those defaults. So that's kind of our initiative, is to look at the whole picture, which we are doing with the assistance of Higher Ed, Edge. And so we're very pleased with the outcome and what that's done for our district. So thank you very much.
Thank you, Cynthia. Okay, Deb, your time starts now.
Now, gotta go. Excuse me, so forgive the cough that I get every once in a while. Thanks for having me. Thank you very much to follow that. Wow. I'm Deb. I need to thank you down here. You kind of clapped when they said my name. I don't have any peeps in the audience like her. So I really, I'm feeling some love here. California to Texas, I'm feeling some warmth, okay? I'm Deb Barker-Garcia, Vice President of Financial Aid at Corinthian Colleges. Thank you for having me here. I've come from California to be with you guys. I oversee about 110 for-profit schools, Everest, Wyotech, and Heald Colleges. I need to tell you guys that this is the first for-profit I've worked in, so I'm very traditional-based, University of Southern California, Ed Fund, the California State University System. So it's been a real eye-opener for me being in the for-profit industry, and I need to tell you, I've learned a lot, and my views have really changed over the past 4 years about what a for-profit education can offer students. Sorry about that, I'm waving the thing. So first, let me ask, do we have any other for-profit schools out here? Oh, come on, you guys. Can somebody lie? Can you? Come on, dude. Just raise your hand. Just help me. Thank you. Okay.
I used to be.
Okay, and she used to. You know, the reason, because the thing that I think was funny, you know, it's she wants us to talk about our most pressing issues, and I'd love to say, oh, we have no, it's all good. It's all good at for-profit. Nobody cares about us. It's all good. but that's not the truth. I think, you know, many of my issues I share with my colleagues up here. You know, one thing that's been talked about in many of the sessions here is gainful employment. So obviously that's huge on our radar, you know, gainful employment and the fact that we're being judged on how much students borrow and what their repayment rates are and their debt to income ratio. And, you know, just as she said, and I saw a couple of you nod, we can counsel and counsel and plead and beg, please don't borrow this, you don't need this, you've got post 9/11, please don't. And they basically look at you and say, thanks for sharing, I'll take that $20,000 or whatever it is they're eligible for. So that's a hard thing, I'm sure, for all of us. You know, I think the point I like to make is that we all come from different segments, but we're truly more alike than different. We have the same concerns. I deal with an incredibly high-risk student population, first-generation college students. I deal with college students that are probably very similar to a community college student sometimes, but where they differ is they don't have the wherewithal to make it through a community college system. When they go to a community college in California and are faced with, you know, the class is impacted and you'll have to come back next semester, they don't come back because they don't have the family support of saying, no, you can do it, you can do it. You know, the other thing I'm dealing with right now is debit cards. How do I implement debit cards on my campus? And I know that's the new dessert of the day. And part of me, when we went down this road, I was like, are you kidding? Corinthian College, is we getting the paper enough on our own? Do I really want to implement a debit card right now? But in looking at it, it's the best thing for my students. It's going to be a good thing for them. I deal with students that don't understand how to bank. They're unbankable. They don't have checking accounts. I need to give them the life skills so that they can succeed. So that's part of why I'm rolling out debit cards on my campus, is to, sure, it helps with the people over, you know, getting the refunds and stuff. But more importantly to me in financial aid, I'm rolling out an entire program on campus teaching students how to become bankable, how to use bill pay, how to not go to that check cashing place down the street and pay 50% interest or whatever it is. You know, I'm spending a lot of my time educating students on things that our parents probably taught us growing up. Our parents showed us how to go to the bank or maybe how to have a little... My students don't know that. They haven't been given those skills. So that's part of my debit card rollout. As I'm sure all of us will talk about, financial literacy and default prevention. Huge, huge concern to us because, again, my students have not been given the skills to succeed. My students' idea of budgeting is they pay the gas bill when the gas gets turned off. That's what budgeting is like for my students. So that's where I almost have to take on the role of mom and dad in rolling out financial literacy programs to these 110 schools, showing them stuff that probably to us is extremely basic, that we learned maybe in fifth grade or sixth grade just by, you know, just by our family situation. So, you know, rolling out financial literacy programs to 110 campuses to give them the life skills that they weren't given growing up. But I think what makes me differ from the rest of my colleagues up here. I think we can all say, yeah, financial literacy, debit cards, gainful employment, you know, default prevention. But what makes my life a little bit different, and I actually hate to say this because I don't want it to seem like I'm whining. I was hoping to have another for-profit in here. But it's the heightened sensitivity to it all. You guys, I can't do anything. I cannot do anything right. And some days it makes me so sad. And I know you don't care. You're like getting out the little violins right now. But let me give you an example. And if you talk about things that are really in my face at a for-profit right now, this is huge. And I'll give you just an example on cohort default rates. When I left Ed Fund back in, whenever Phil went away, 4 years ago, 4.5 years ago, and came to Corinthian Colleges, I met with the CEO and I said, you guys have a default issue here. You know, did you see when I was at Ed Fund, I ran these 3-year simulated default rates, and did you see what was going to happen? And they kind of said, well, I'm sure you have some great ideas. Let us know about them someday. Well, that was in June. In about August, they woke up and they were like, holy moly, we've got a default issue here. Did you know that? And I'm like, yeah. And the default issue was so bad. At the time, 2008 rates were coming out, and we were headed into 2009 2-year rates. And I will tell you, what we were facing was what I would consider to be an enterprise risk. You know, your default rates are tied to your main OPEID. Mm-hmm. So we had a couple schools, actually, Texas was the worst. And I gotta tell you, I don't know what it is. Our Texas schools are some of the worst schools that we have to deal with in terms of helping the students succeed financially and with financial literacy and everything. But we were in a situation where we had 5 campuses tied to an OPEID that was going to hit 40%. So that's what, when I say it was an enterprise risk, it was, that was going to shut down Title IV for 5 campuses, you know, and forget about the campus. You know, my motto in default prevention, whenever I speak at CASFA or anything like that, I always talk about, do the right thing for the student, and your school's going to be fine. If I do the right thing for the students, Corinthian College is going to be fine. So I went down the road of implementing a lot of default prevention programs. We started calling students. You know, we developed our own call center so that we could call students. I put campus student loan specialists on every campus. I rewrote entrance counseling and exit counseling because my students, they can't get through the Department of Ed stuff. They can't do it. I don't want to read it, you know? I mean, have you guys looked at it lately? I don't want to read it. It's awful. It's lovely if there's any department people. But it's, I mean, do you guys want to read it? You look at it, and when they came out with their new and improved site, you know, I was like, oh, it's new and improved. And I went, and I was like, oh, no, not really. You know, so I rewrote the entrance and exit. And then I also put in mandatory financial literacy programs for all of our campuses. Make a long story short, in a period of a year, I threw everything and the kitchen sink and the bathroom and the beds and everything at default prevention because we had to take care of it and we had to be aggressive. So what wound up happening was because of that was in 2009, I did not have any schools hit 40%. We came in okay. But as we all know, it takes a year or two to get your default prevention programs working. So what happened with my 2010 rates is they dropped. And you know, and I all of a sudden I had this buzz. Why did your rates drop? Why did your rates drop? And one of my answers was, well, because we did something. You know, they weren't doing anything before. We did something, so they dropped. But it was really because we put things into place. So then what happens at my school, the for-profit school? In the papers, then what happens is not, oh, congratulations, the for-profit school, you know, implemented all these amazing programs and dropped their default rate. All of a sudden, I was accused of pushing students into forbearances and falsifying stuff. And this, nobody could accept the fact that we just did a good job. We put programs in. So that's what I talk about, the heightened sensitivity, is that everything we do is, it's almost like we're guilty first and we have to prove our innocence. And I hate to even say that because I don't want it to sound like, oh, poor is, you know, woe is us. Because I will tell you, are we perfect? Absolutely not. But if I go back to California, is University of Southern California perfect or UCLA perfect? Absolutely not. But you know what? We do a lot of good. And there's a certain type of student that we serve really well. And what I've learned is that we're given a responsibility with these high-risk students. And while we let them all in, my responsibility is to take care of them and to make sure I've implemented the right programs to get them out of there. But that heightened everybody, the newspaper, I mean, open the newspaper every day. You're going to see another story. Corinthian, we're in the paper all the time. You guys should know me. I mean, because evidently we're really evil. It makes me really, really sad sometimes. You know, a couple weeks ago I was working on, redoing some veterans programs, veterans military education training programs. And once again, another lawsuit hit from somebody. And I was like, I cannot win here. So that's a little twist. Even in implementing the debit card situation that I looked at, I'm getting my where's my music? Aren't you going to play music for me? Can you sing? Okay.
No, we cut right through the chase.
But I was going to say, even in the debit card situation, we are probably having to be so much more on top of things than a normal traditional school, because I know it's only a matter of time, despite my best efforts, where it will get twisted. So again, not to poor Deb, poor at Corinthian. Just the reality of it is. So, Millette.
There you go.
Thank you, Deb. It takes two mics.
It's a lot. You know, there's a lot here. So I'm just. hi, everybody. Thanks for coming. I for a long time at TCU, was over the loan program. So that's kind of where I lived for about 10 years. And about a year ago, someone on our campus retired, and I shifted over, and so now I'm doing verification and Pell Grants and return of funds and that kind of fun. So in implementing some changes to our verification process just to kind of streamline it, you know, we had like 33 different forms or something, and, you know, just kind of making that happen. And then, of course, the department comes along, and love you if you're here, and and, you know, we have this new verification.
Here, okay, just new, for the record, they are not here.
I wish they were. But this new kind of V6, right? The V6. And so when we got the initial information, we started looking at it. You know, there was just so little there about, you know, if you don't think these people have sufficient income, then you need to do some more research. And we had been doing that on our campus for a number of years. We had we called it the low income statement, but it really, that's not what the form was called, but that's what we called it internally. But it was called the statement of income versus expenses. And so we'd been doing that for years, and many of you, I'm sure, have you know, a similar process. And one of the things that we had struggled with and sort of have had an internal debate about for a number of years was, you know, what we were doing with that information was inconsistent. We weren't always treating that information the same way. And what had begun to happen, I think, is we were using, because we were collecting expenses, not just income, but we were collecting expenses, that form had become sort of I think unintentionally, you know, you can look at that form and sort of judge a person's lifestyle, right? So you can look at that and go, well, I don't think you should live in a $3 million house. Like, I just don't think that's right. But, and I'm exaggerating, but that, you know, or, you know, we asked them for what kind of cars they drove and what the make was. And what we were trying to get to was, how are you paying? Here's what you need in a month, and here's what you report on the FAFSA, and they don't match. The problem was that when we were collecting expenses, invariably we were treating, you know, people who, you know, maybe their lifestyle was a sort of a different stratosphere than, you know, than ours, or than, you know, what we consider our normal sort of typical student. And so, you know, invariably what happened is, if we were, say, using professional judgment to add something to their FAFSA, add some untaxed income, add some, you know, some kind of support, that cash support or something like that, invariably when we ran the numbers, the amounts that we were adding to the families who sort of we thought were living, you know, up there, was more in dollars than what we were adding to the others. And, you know, we can have a debate about whether or not that's okay. But the point is, the FAFSA, right, the federal methodology, does not attempt to judge lifestyle. Mm-hmm. It doesn't judge expenses. It doesn't judge what you've chosen to do and where you've chosen to live and what the cars you've chosen to buy. So that was what our internal debate consisted of, is how do we, you know, make sure that the right people are getting a Pell Grant, right, and that the wrong people are not getting one, and yet follow the federal methodology and not sort of go beyond it. So this V6 thing came up, and we sort of went, oh, okay, so this is going to kind of curtail with all that. And so then we started talking about what sufficient means. And, you know, when we had collected income and expenses, that was easy, because sufficient meant you could cover what you told me your expenses were. If we weren't going to collect expenses, and I had a pretty difficult time convincing my boss this, that there was some way that we could not collect expenses and still figure out what sufficient income was. And since the department, we don't know what their criteria are for selecting the V6 group, you know, I think we kind of found ourselves without a leg to stand on, so to speak. We weren't sure where to start. What is sufficient? You know, what does that mean? And we really struggled with it. And I did some, I Googled, because that's what I do to find answers to all of life's problems. It is. Google knows everything. So I Googled sufficient income, the quotes, sufficient income. And what you get, the very first hit that comes up is a site called earnsufficientincome.com. So I click on that. Because that's wise, right? So it's so science. I mean, it's all science. So that, what that site is, it's a work from home site, right? Where you go buy a packet of stuff and they send it to you, and you can make $1 million in a month, or, you know, whatever. So that's what that is. Okay, so that wasn't very helpful. And then the third thing on the list is, like, the first two links were actually about sufficient income. By number three, it was starting to give definitions of insufficient. So insufficient income, and that's like things about insufficient income to get a credit card. Insufficient income, you know, if somebody denies you for a credit card because you have insufficient income, or denies you for a mortgage loan, or, you know, something like that. So I got a lot of that. And then the fifth thing, you know, hit on Google was Bishop State Community College in Mobile, Alabama, was their insufficient parent income form. So that's it. That's all there is in the world, because Google has everything. about to help us with, what is this concept? What does that even mean? You know, I mean, I don't know about you guys, but I got families on my campus who are everything from food stamps to $3 million house, right? And they all appeal for financial aid. So how do you define what sufficient is? And I'll be real honest with you. We, at some point, given the timing we had and all that kind of stuff, we had to implement something. And so, you know, without something better to do, to use, we're using the poverty level. And, you know, I'm not comfortable with that, for several reasons, one of which is that the poverty level was never intended for this type of purpose. It was, you know, it was designed in the 60s based on reports, some of which were from the 30s. And it's, you know, the CPI, of course, it increases every year a little bit and that kind of thing. So it's, I don't mean to say we're using the numbers we used in the 60s, but the concepts behind it, which are based on, you know, food plans put out by the Department of Agriculture and, you know, things like that. It's a very, you know, it was never intended to be used for some of the purposes it's intended for. I think that in the final analysis, again, we didn't have, we couldn't find anything better. And so for this year, we're for 14-15, we're gonna use the poverty level for the number of people in the household. And when we request the V6 information, untaxed income and what have you, we're gonna try to get those folks to that level. Still watching, we just did a training on it last week, and I had to, you know, talk to my counselors about still being very cognizant of that concept of conflicting information, and it's more than, you know, okay, it's conflicting information if someone says they're single and or they're married and filed ahead of household. Okay, that's conflicting information, okay, because you can't do that. But it's, I'm not talking about things that obvious. I'm talking about, you know, what else do you see on the FAFSA that just sort of throws up a red flag, right? And I think the V6 group, we seem to be getting into that. I was talking with Cecilia about it earlier, and she said something that I think hits it right on the head. It feels like professional judgment, right? So verification, right, which is supposed to be, right, no judgment involved, right? You just do the thing. And now all of a sudden we're in a professional judgment situation in verification. And so it's very, the lines are getting very, very blurry. And so on my campus, we're trying very hard not to let that happen. We're trying to have, because we want it applied consistently, we don't want one counselor doing it one way, one counselor doing it another way. We have five people reviewing verification files. So, you know, we're trying to make that, to get some consistency and to make that work. But it's been a challenge. And so if anybody has any great ideas, I'm an expert, but I came to get your help. to help, or if you have any, you know, I'd love to hear about them at the end, because that really has been a huge struggle for us. We've spent a lot of time talking about it, so.
Thank you, Millette.
The mark of true expert is to know when to ask, you know? So, hey, you know, awesome. Hi, everybody, I'm James, and I'm going to talk a little bit today about something a little different than what we've been talking about here, and this is in how the financial aid office can help support the recruitment effort, because recruiting students, getting students enrolled and retained, that's the lifeblood of the university. And without the students, there are no institutions, and we don't have jobs. To give you a little bit of background about my school. We're a small school, about 1,500 students, traditional undergraduate liberal arts school, mostly residential. So we deal with the more traditional families, but we're also one of the higher priced schools here. Our cost of attendance this year is gonna be at $49,090. It's a pretty high price tag, but the good news is that over 60% of our students receive some kind of need-based funding, and a quarter of our students are actually Pell Grant recipients. So we have a pretty broad base student population. We have an enrollment services model where admissions and financial aid both report to the same VP. That VP really pushes the promotion of the institution, the selling of the institution, the recruitment of the student, and developing a relationship with the family from the get-go, and a very personal kind of relationship, and also expects the recruiters to be able to talk fluently about financial aid. When he first came, we had a recruiting staff that was very experienced and could talk fairly eloquently about financial aid. But then over a period of about a year or 2 years, through retirements and pursuit of other opportunities, we went from a staff that was full of veterans to a staff that was full of rookies. And so that gave us in the financial aid office an opportunity to kind of break down some of those silos and to integrate the work of the two offices
to support that recruitment effort, and also give the admission recruiters a little bit more background, a little more comfort level with being able to talk about financial aid. So to do that, we did a few kind of fun things in getting them used to and comfortable with handling some of those somewhat difficult conversations that they may have with families. In addition to just letting them know the basics, what our deadlines are, what the full scope of the opportunities that we have available. We also brought them in for a day of packaging training, where we actually sat down, yes, admission recruiters and packaging. Let me tell you, that was a lot of fun. But we did go through the whole process of how you get from EFC to a package, and the admission recruiters were very receptive to that information, and we had a lot of fun doing it too. We broke into small groups, and each of the groups did these little packaging scenarios. Had a lot of fun doing it. The goal there was not to get them to package students because that's what our computers are for. What we wanted them to do was understand how packages works, understand the dynamics behind the packages, also to understand the eligibility requirements, what it takes to be awarded a Pell Grant, what it takes to be awarded a tuition equalization grant, Stafford loan, all of that. Again, so that when the counselors were in a situation where they were trying to work through a financial aid award letter with a family, they could answer most of the questions. Another challenge that we knew we were going to be facing is that our enrollment was projected to be going up. That was one of the goals that was put on our division, and so we knew we were going to have to figure out how to support a larger number of students coming through our office, but with the same amount of staff. Having that information and being able to let the admission recruiters know how to handle a lot of those frontline questions allowed the financial aid staff to handle some of the more complex situations, like some of these V6 things we got going on here. So there was that. We also took them through the completion of a FAFSA. Took them through that test site that the Department of Ed has, and walked them through completing a FAFSA, so that again they could handle those frontline questions and help the family fill out a FAFSA when the family felt more comfortable dealing with the admission officer versus the financial aid officer. Another thing that we did to help the admission staff was to assign an admission staff member to a financial aid staff member. So that person had a contact in the financial aid office that they could go to with any of their questions that they had. And admissions and financial aid is in the same building, and we saw that relationship to be a pretty valuable one for the recruiters. I kept seeing recruiters going into my staff offices many, many times over the course of the recruitment season, and we were real happy to see that. We wanted that relationship to develop because, as you all know, that being able to answer those complex questions that a family has helps to make that interaction with the families much more positive, and helps to recruit students. A few more things that we did. We did adapt our financial aid letter to be more user friendly. We took a cue from the shopping sheet and expanded that a little bit more to not only present financial aid in a way that was a little bit more easy for families to understand, but also presented them options on how to cover the part that wasn't covered by other forms of financial aid. We rolled that aid letter out to the recruiters prior to the letters going out, so that once the letters hit, the recruiters knew how to guide a family through that letter and how to answer the questions that inevitably result from those letters going out. And then, of course, the admission staff also got a little bit more visible in what we were doing with the different recruitment functions. On our campus visit days, instead of just making a presentation and going home at the end of the day, we set up our office to handle individual family appointments. And in fact, we've got one going on this weekend, another one going on later on this month, where we're going to be pre-registering students at that point for the fall semester, and sitting down with them and saying, okay, what's the financial plan? Let's work something out. We're going to get their PLUS loans approved. We're going to get their Stafford loan entrance counseling done, and get those students who are deposited locked in so that we don't have to worry about them further on down the line. We also had some calling nights earlier this semester, where after financial aid letters went out, our recruiters started contacting families to we call it calling in the financial aid award letter, the recruiters walked those families through those letters. The financial aid staff was available to handle, again, the more complex questions. If a recruiter got caught in a situation where they couldn't handle those questions, they passed them on to us, and we were able to take it from there. And these were late evenings, but we had a lot of fun with it. Brought in the pizza, brought in the Jimmy John's, and everybody was happy.
You mean Jimmy John showed up?
Jimmy, hey, you know, freaky fast. And then we were also very visible at the fall recruitment events. Started developing relationships with some families even as early as the fall. Believe me, those people came back to us in the spring and hunted us down because they had the questions. Those were the big things that we did to help our efforts in recruiting students. I think that it's a relationship that's going to continue to develop. We've got some ideas for next year, including pulling the financial aid counselors through the calculation of an EFC. But as you all know, that can be mind-boggling even to the most experienced financial aid officer. But we're gonna try that and see how it works. Okay.
Thank you, James.
You bet.
That's enough, Cynthia. Don't you scoot anymore. Stop. Right. How's that? All right. Your time starts now.
Thank you. Again, I'm Cecilia Jones. A couple of people have already mentioned default management, default aversion already, but my subject is coming from the HBCU or Minority Service Institution perspective. And as you know, most of us, or a lot of us, or some of us, whichever way you want to put it, are in default trouble. Some of us have already had the two-year published, 30% or above, and are contemplating the third year. So we had to come, not from the aversion standpoint, but with aversion and plus the management of what the state we're in now. I can tell you, I'm gonna tell you a little story of how serious it was. I think the preliminaries came out in 2008. I'm lying in bed Saturday morning, half asleep. I get a call, I look at my cell phone, and I say, who is calling me from the school? It's Saturday. I answer the phone, it's the president. First of all, I wanted to know how he got my cell number. So I'm looking at the phone like, couldn't answer him at first. He said, did you see this article in the Chronicle? They're calling me. I need you to help me answer this question. And I said, oh. I just sat there. Are you there? Yes, sir, I'm there. I'm here. give me a few minutes. I was asleep. So what I had to help him answer that question, because at that point it was 41%. Since then, that started the urgency and the management and the plans and things like that. The first thing we did, we acquired a new third-party servicer, which is TG, Higher Edge, and
no pressure.
No pressure. And they helped us establish a new plan. We already had a plan, but apparently we weren't working that plan. So,
which was part of the plan.
Yeah, part of the plan. So we had to
develop a, create a new plan, and we reestablished the default management team, which was required at that point after the first publication of the 30%. You're required to submit a plan to the Department of Ed, and you're required to create a management team as part of that. And we did that. We started a rigorous, concern and concentration on default management. We had meetings every week. Default management plan, we had established, because we're going to meet once a month. That wasn't enough. We got to the point where we were meeting every week, and it wasn't just the team. The president would come down, and we couldn't even go through our agenda because he would take up the whole time from his giving his opinion or whatever. But from then, but after that, we focused and set up a plan of action for that. Some of the consequences of default management, in case you don't know, of course, is the negative reflect on the institution, and it could also result in provisional certification with your PPA agreement. And of course, you can, if we reach that third year, you can lose your Title IV funding for two years up front, and minimize your access to private loans. After you reach the second year, you will have to submit a revised plan because the department thinks you need something extra. Of course, your first plan must not be working. So you'll have to submit a second plan at that time. And also, what we did an analysis on our defaulters. Our major, of course, most of you know, are stopouts. Some of the other things that Antonio and I came up with from his institution and mine, those students who would have to leave for military, came out low wages, trouble with personal relationships, unemployed, medical bills, and lack of knowledge was a big one. And because of that lack of knowledge, we started a rigorous program where the institution I am now, we have a grant for financial literacy. And so we've increased our financial literacy workshops on campus. We increase in-school deferment activities. Forms. We contacted students before time. We had workshops on SAP. We were trying to think of everything. We had changed from just the online counseling. We implemented in-person counseling for exit and entrance. And for our withdrawal students, we start contacting them, encouraging them to re-enroll. They must see a retention counselor officer before withdrawing. Those students who are withdrawing officially, we mail them an exit packet, along with information. We use servicer mail, grace mail. We use servicer mail grace letters. I'm sorry, servicer grace letters in order to give them more information. Also, we increase information on our graduate students for our graduate students also, not just completing a form to graduate, getting signatures. You know, you have to go to different departments. But we required every graduate to attend a session before we would sign off. And before the registrar's office would sign that last line saying that they're eligible to graduate, if they hadn't received notification from our default financial aid office, we wouldn't approve them to graduate. Yeah, we wouldn't sign that put that last signature on there. We've increased our contact information. We, as part of that program, we did monthly focus titles or subjects or like November would be prosperity, you know, it's Thanksgiving, you know, things like that. We would think of something to go with the month. And with that month, we would design financial literacy based on those subjects. That's one of the things we did also with our financial literacy. We had sessions with different departments, different organizations, athletes, Greeks. We would have sessions with them. We tried to increase our financial literacy because we found that lack of knowledge was our major issue. And I think at one point, I told them at the beginning of the fall semester, we had so many sessions that everybody was saying, I don't want a loan. We gave them too much knowledge because they didn't want loans at all. But because of the gap between the cost of attendance that some of them still had to get loans, so we had to give them a talk about the good debt versus the bad debt then. Last thing we did, I wanted to encourage again, is partnerships, like with TG and other agencies. Like I said, we received a grant from USAF for our financial literacy. So just wanted to get to sum it up, to let you know the seriousness of this nature, I Googled the impacts of high default rate, and the first article that came up was from the Chronicle, and it was just printed a couple of weeks ago. There are, over the U.S., there are 104 institutions facing sanctions after September who have already received 2 years of 30% or above and are facing the third year.
Thank you, Cecilia. That's so much information, my head hurts. And Deb, I feel your pain. I really do. Having started at a for-profit institution, even way back then, we couldn't do anything right. And then going to a large private institution, I realized just how smart we were. We knew more than they did. We did more than they did. And you couldn't touch us with a 10-foot pole. But the perception and the oversight was tremendous. So hang in there, all right? We need you there. Hang in there. Okay, we've got a few minutes for questions or comments or ideas for our panel members, and I know they're very eager to hear all of those things. So we've got about 10 minutes. Right, LaDonna? Okay, good. Uh-oh.
Millett, and actually this is for the panel as well. When you are looking at the substantial income, is that correct?
Sufficient income.
I'm sorry about that.
Right.
When we looked at this in the past from the Dallas County Community College District and from another school that I attended or worked at, I guess. sometimes I was thinking I attended it too. One of the things we looked at is when we set these income thresholds, then the students would just meet or match that income threshold and not really, let's say, they would make errors in reporting the information.
they
lied, yes.
And it's hard to keep it straight.
How exactly do you get around that? Because I understand, you know, you have to have a basis, because otherwise it is professional judgment.
It is. Mm-hmm. We don't tell them.
You don't tell them? That secret doesn't get out?
We're like the Department of Education. We just don't tell them what the threshold is.
Okay, okay. Well, we have whole Facebook pages dedicated
where they talk,
to
yeah, where they
how
talk
to
each other.
Commit fraud on our institution.
Sure.
So
that's very useful. I think you're right. And I guess, you know, obviously this is, you know, it's the first time for all of us to kind of, at least to have to do it. Like I said, we've done it for years, but it was absolutely arbitrary. I mean, I can tell you without, you know, and we didn't always do it the same way, and that was really the problem. But it really,
I mean, it's an excellent question. I think, but I do think we can take the lead from the department. I mean, the reason the department won't tell us is because we, you know, students would find out and they would do it on the FAFSA, right? So, so I think we have to sort of play a similar game. You know, it won't take long if we all decide to use the poverty level. It won't take long for them to know that, and we will have not most students, because most students tell the truth, but the ones who aren't going to. We'll figure that out really quickly. So mm-hmm. I think it's an absolutely valid point. And, you know, that's one of the reasons. And frankly, I think it's interesting the department hasn't given us, not just that they didn't tell us what the criteria are, because that actually, it's annoying, but it makes sense. But they didn't tell us what sufficient income means, right? So they didn't define that for us. Now, I don't want them to define that for us, because I doubt we would like it. Mm-hmm. So I don't want them to define that for us. And frankly, I think one of the reasons that they shouldn't is the difference in, I know that the FAFSA takes into account in some very minor ways where a student lives, but the cost of living differences are atrocious mm-hmm. across, you know, any of us who have students from, especially outside of Texas, mm-hmm. you know, our California students, I mean, you know, we look at their home values, for example, and go, oh, you've got to be kidding me. But it's really, it is. But they actually live in a box. Yeah, I mean, it's just outrageous. And so I think that's one of the reasons that, you know, we have to know our own populations. We know our own populations better than the department does. And I think, you know, they're sort of acknowledging that. Or they just couldn't figure it out either. But yeah, it's a good point. You're right. They'll figure it out pretty quick.
Anyone else on the panel want to address that before we go to the next question? Okay, great. Next question.
I'm from Michigan, and I'm from a large community college. And we have 28 community colleges in our state. Four of them have default rates above 30%. One has 2 years above 30%. Mm-hmm. And I guess my question would be to Cynthia, relative to number one, how do you make good contact with the students after they leave? Because we find, both through our efforts and through the efforts of the organization we've hired to assist us, that if you get to 15% of being able to, 15% of those that are in delinquency or are in our cohort default rate, to be able to contact that many of them, that's a good month. And secondly, we have found that probably three of the four colleges that have default rates above 30%, there seems to have been some large fraud rings and a number of students who, whether they're in a fraud ring or not, are your Pell runners, your loan runners, mm-hmm. that type of thing. And have you heard that? Anybody here heard that from other parts of the country? And you know, what do we think? What do you think we should do as financial aid administrators to advocate for those kinds of things? You know, to be able to look for, because as law reads right now, you know, we're not seeing and any differently than the four-year school or the private college that has a much more traditional population, where default usually isn't as big a problem. So number one, the contact, how to get good contact information to. Relative to this thing about fraud rings and Pell runners, loan runners.
Well, thank you for your questions. Communicating with the students, I think, has been a big issue for us as well. For instance, just exit counseling. How do you determine when a student is separated from the institution?
Right.
When you have seven different colleges, you have transient students, they're in school, they're out of school, they're back in school. It's been very problematic and a huge challenge for us. And so we are beginning that process as we speak. And fortunately, I have an area in the financial aid district office that is geared towards default aversion. And I have some top people in that area that work on that program and work consistently with TG's Higher Edge to resolve those issues. But I'll give you some statistical information that I think you might find helpful. Since we've partnered with TG to assist with this communication process, number one, I will tell you that we had TG that was recently at our district office to kind of just give us an update of where we are, because we just began this process with them last August, really. And so we haven't even had a full year yet to have a real full impact on the CDRs, but it is having an impact on contacting our students and working with our students while they're in school for financial literacy, working with them during their grace periods, so that when they begin the repayment process, they're already aware of what their repayment options are. And like you said, Cecilia, in some cases, it's not having the information, not having the knowledge, not knowing what to do or who to contact or kind of what options that they have. But when we partnered with TG, to give you an example, and this is data as of February of 2014, we had 76.8% increase to our cohort size for our district. That was pretty significant. As of FY11, we had 58,286 outbound calls launched through February. That is huge. And I will tell you that prior to the partnering with TG, we didn't have the ability to do that. In fact, when we looked at the statistical analysis, before we decided to go out there for an official RFP for assistance with this process, we really did not have a formalized methodology for being able to contact our students because we are so large. It's like, where do you start? And when you start looking at the statistical analysis, we would have had to have had like 10 full-time staff members doing nothing but default aversion. Well, we don't have the dollars to do that. We don't have the staff to do that. So we knew that we needed help, number one. But when we saw that there are 58,000 calls made on our behalf, and when they call our students as an example, they don't call and say that they're from higher ed. They don't call to say that they're from the district. They call as representation from each of our colleges so that the students have identity with each of the colleges. So if they attended Richland College, they're going to have a call from Richland College. So number one, we think that that's very important that they understand that it is someone on behalf of Richland College that's calling them to assist them for default aversion. We had 4,247 borrowers cured through February. There were 1,917 phone contacts through February. That and remember, this is not something that we really even had the ability to do. We'd done somewhat, you know, a minimal amount, but nothing compared to this. Higher Edge, as an example, provides a toll-free dedicated number that is specific to our district, so our students know that they can call the 800 number for assistance. They've even started texting students, and we all know that students text like crazy. I mean, that's one of the ways they communicate, as well as Facebook. So we're looking at all the different mechanisms. Technology is an example on how we can best reach students, because the communication methodology is important for us, not just through default aversion, but from every other communication method, and to reach a student, because we know they don't read, right? So you have to contact them in a manner that they are accustomed to using, in a manner that they're going to use, number one. And so we're finding a lot of different initiatives through technology in staying in tune with our students. So I hope that gives you some areas maybe that will assist you as far as your concerns with how to communicate with students. So we needed help in that area. We just couldn't do it on our own. And we felt that we had to partner. So we did the official RFP for the default aversion program. And when we did that process and when we finalized the selection of that, it was who could provide the full picture for us, not just turning around a cohort defaulted student. How are you going to prevent our students from going into delinquency? How are you going to turn around our defaults? Those were two initiatives that we were concerned with. And so from my perspective and from our perspective, it is education, financial literacy, working with students while they're in school during the grace period so that before they begin the repayment, and hopefully before they ever enter into default, that they know the mechanisms to communicate that, to ask for help, to get assistance that will prevent our students from going into those areas that we don't want them to go to. So that's one of the reasons why we looked at this specific company to assist us, because we needed the whole picture. We didn't just need a company that was out there and specializing in turning around your cohort defaulted students. We needed to prevent them from going into default, which meant you had to start contacting these students, communicating with these students before they even leave school, and then communicating them with them consistently throughout the entire repayment process. So that's the way that we've kind of approached that. As far as your second question concerning the Pell Runners, Loan Runners, we've had some of those at our district as well. I can't speak on regards to that as much as maybe some of my staff can that has been intimately involved with that. James, do you want to try to answer that, because you've been very involved in that process?
Well, I will tell you this, and we have seen the fraud rings come in, and the Department of Education really actually is doing a pretty good job of identifying them. And with respect, we've had some prosecutions that we've seen come down the pike, where we've had some of our former students who are now spending their time making license plates because they were involved in this process. And we have OIG contacting us quite a bit now, asking for records so that they can put the cases together to prosecute. So we are kind of seeing that now. We're located in the Northern District of Texas. We're real close to the federal courthouse, so it's really easy to get our students. Just walk down the street and get to us. So we are seeing that, and we have started to identify some of the rings as well. And some of it's through unusual enrollment history, and a lot of it is through, believe it or not, high school completion, because we are seeing a huge amount of diploma mills come through because of that. You know, and so we are, because the Department of Education is, in some districts have said they're starting to prosecute schools, we've started saying, no, I'm sorry, you're going to have to find a GED or something of that nature. We're starting to deny them aid based upon that they didn't complete high school.
That even if you identify the student, the department's not going to take that out. Those individuals out of your cohort default rate, and that's what I'm talking about. Is as financial aid administrators, if your area's been targeted, and you have lots of these students that have gone into default because of that, you know, to me that seems like an unusual something that those schools should be given some special consideration.
Extenuating circumstances.
Exactly. And, I think that's where we as financial aid administrators could make could step forward and say, you know, if this is the case, then give us some relief. Because we don't have relief on the other end of denying loans and, right. You know, except under professional judgment and that kind of thing.
Absolutely. And I agree with you. And that's why you have the ability to challenge those cohort default rates during this time frame when they're not the official ones, they're draft, and you only have those 45 days to get that done. And so I have my default aversion team, stand up guys, that do this right now for us, for our district, and we are challenging some of those with the assistance of our partnership with Higher Edge, so that, you know, we have the ability to impact those cohort default rates. So I would encourage you to utilize that process to challenge any of those that you feel are not warranted for your institution.
Thank you, Cynthia. We're over time, but we're going to take one more question, one last question.
It really wasn't a question. I just wanted the panel to know what a good job they done. And Cynthia made the statement that, you know, students think school is a career. That's wherever you go.
Thank you. I agree wholeheartedly. It just never surprises me how many wonderful experts and how much information we have in this field. It was very easy to pick out experts in each of the particular sectors, and I am truly grateful for your participation and putting up with me and all the conference calls and all the preparation. And this audience and this area appreciates your hard work. And let's show them a real Texas thank you and welcome. Okay, your next session starts at, I'm just kidding. Thank you and see you all tomorrow.